A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Brother and sister, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. We'll be starting this seminar with the recitation of Holy Quran, and I would request our young student of our madrasa, Talha, for recitation of the Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحج أشهر معلومات فمن فرض فيهن الحج فلا رفث ولا فسوق ولا جدال في الحج وما تفعلوا من خير يعلمه الله وتزودوا فإن خير الزاد التقوى واتقون يا أولي الألباب ليس عليكم جناح أن تبتغوا فضلا من ربكم فإذا أفضتم من عرفات فاذكروا الله عند المشعر الحرام واذكروه كما هداكم وإن كنتم من قبله لمن الضالين ثم أفيضوا من حيث أفاض الناس واستغفروا الله إن الله غفور رحيم فإذا قضيتم مناسككم فاذكروا الله كذكركم آباءكم أو أشد ذكرا فمن الناس من يقول ربنا آتنا في الدنيا وما له في الآخرة من خلاق ومنهم من يقول ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار أولئك لهم نصيب مما كسبوا والله سريع الحساب صدق الله العظيم.
Jazakallah, Brother Talha. Brother and sisters, today we are going to talk about a very special journey. You know, in our daily lives, we make journey, we move from place to place. But the journey we are going to talk about today is a very special journey. And this is a lifetime journey. Very significant journey, which nobody can take, nobody can undertake that journey unless there is approval of Allah. And there is an invitation from the Allah. So for this special journey, how prepared we are, what preparation should be taken from our side. We have two speakers today, Brother Yusuf Badat and Dr. Mumtaz. They will be speaking on the rituals of Hajj, and Dr. Mumtaz will be talking about the healthcare during the Hajj journey. So without standing more over here, I will now request Imam Yusuf Badat Sahab to please come to the podium and talk about rituals of Hajj.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. So brothers and sisters, I want to begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and sending salutations upon the final messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I want to also thank the organizers for putting this important program together, as well as all of you who have come out here to learn about this important pillar of Islam. And according to my assumption, I understand that most of you are proceeding for Hajj. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless your pilgrimage and your Hajj, And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fill it with acceptance and mercy, with all your du'as and your prayers accepted. And may you return safely with all the blessings to our communities, inshallah. So I have a limitation of time, and in the best interest of using our time appropriately here, I have been given the task of speaking about the rituals of Hajj, meaning the manasik of Hajj, which are the general regulations related to Hajj. So I will give a brief outline of this, and we will begin by looking at Umrah, and then we will go into the procedure of Hajj because they are very similar. So quoting verses of the Quran, we have plenty verses that speak about the obligation of Hajj. Just one verse so that we can get into this discussion here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the verses of Surah Al-Imran, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنِ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is a duty upon those who have the ability to travel for Hajj. So we hear a very clear verse here which is speaking about the obligation of Hajj. The Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, he instructed فَحُجُّ, that all of you should perform Hajj. And in a famous narration, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, Man hajja lillah, a person who performs Hajj for the sake of Allah, raja'a ka yawmin waladathu ummuh. When they return, they are just like a newborn baby, free and clean from sin and all types of evil. So, as mentioned in the introduction, that this is a very sacred journey, and this journey cannot be accomplished without the decision and the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah has literally selected you, hand-picked each and every one of you to proceed for the pilgrimage. And this is a tremendous, great bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continue to bless us. Now when it comes to the reports, there are many narrations that speak about the importance of Hajj. The Messenger, peace and blessings upon him, said, a person who has the ability to perform Hajj, yet does not perform Hajj, then they should die in any faith they wish. So we understand the obligation here. And on the reverse, the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, speaks about the person who makes the sacrifice to the journey of Hajj, how they are blessed and they are given tremendous rewards both in this world as well as the hereafter. So there are several ways of performing Hajj, and in specifically, in very a summary point view, the Hajj can be rendered in three ways. Number one is that we perform Hajj only. Number two is we perform Hajj and Umrah together. And this can be done in one of two ways. We perform Umrah and Hajj with the very same ihram, with the very same intention. And this is what we call Qiran. And then there's another type of Hajj that is generally performed with Umrah, where you have two intentions and two ihrams. Two intentions and two ihrams means that you get into ihram and you perform your Umrah, and then when it's time for Hajj, you get into another ihram, a new intention, and you perform your Hajj. So in between the two, meaning the Umrah and the Hajj, there is a space where you're not in the state of ihram. And this is what we call tamattu', and most people in today's time, they render the tamattu', meaning that they put on the ihram, they perform Umrah, and then they get out of their ihram, and then they get into another ihram when it's the time for Hajj, and complete the Hajj. So two ihrams. And this is what we're looking at, the obligations that are connected to Umrah. Now, in a very summary point form, there are four main elements when we perform Umrah. And when we talk about Hajj, these will be repeated. So what are the four main elements? There are two that are fard, and there are two that are wajib. Fard, we all know, means it's mandatory, it must be rendered. Wajib, we know, it means that it's necessary. However, the difference between the fard and the wajib is that if a fard is left out, the obligation is not completed. You have to repeat it. For example, in salah, it's fard to do ruku. It's fard to go into sujood, bowing and prostration. So if someone doesn't prostrate in their salah, they have to repeat their salah. So this is a fard. And wajib is that if a person misses the wajib, then they can make up for it. An example in the prayer is that if a person missed the first sitting, you know, we sit two times in a four rakah salah or a four unit prayer. If a person missed the first sitting after two rakahs, this is wajib. So if they miss that, they can make up for it by performing sujood sahu, a prostration, two prostrations before making salam at the end, at the conclusion of the prayer. So when a person misses the wajib, all they have to do is make up that missed thing with another action. So we're looking at two parts of Umrah, two elements of Umrah that are fard. And what are they? The ihram and the tawaf. This is fard. So if someone performs Hajj or Umrah, someone performs Umrah and they don't put on the ihram, or they don't make tawaf, then they have to repeat the entire Umrah. And when it comes to the wajib, there are two elements. One is the sa'i and one is the halaq, which refers to either shaving or trimming the hair. So we're going to look at each one of these in some detail, and then we'll move on to Hajj immediately subsequently after that. So let's look at ihram. So this is something that is mandatory. It's fard. Literally, ihram comes from the word haram. So it can mean prohibited, or it can also mean very sacred. So when a person is in the state of ihram, certain things that are permissible, they become haram, they become forbidden. Just like when we're fasting, when we're in roza, when we're fasting, eating and drinking become haram upon us during the time of fasting. So in a similar fashion, when a person is in the state of ihram, there are certain things that become haram and forbidden. This is why ihram is known as ihram. And ihram can also come from sacred. And obviously when a person is in the state of ihram performing umrah or hajj, they are in a very blessed and sacred position. So what is required in the ihram? Number one is we need to be in the state of ihram before we get into the boundary. So we have a map here that we can see Makkah right there at the bottom, and at the top we can see Medina. So Makkah is inside the boundary, Medina is outside the boundary. So I'm not sure if some of you are going to Medina first or going directly to Medina, but those people who are going directly to Mecca from Jeddah, then they should be in the state of ihram before they land. The average time span is that 2 hours before landing, you should be in the state of ihram. So if you're landing in Jeddah, 2 hours before you land, you should get into ihram and you should make your intention. And if you're going to Medina, then you don't need to be in the state of ihram. You can be in your normal clothing and your normal intention. And once you're ready to leave Medina to go to Mecca, then you would get into the state of ihram. Second part is when you get into your state of ihram, it's sunnah to take a bath. Before we get into ihram, it's sunnah to take a bath. If we can't take a bath for some reason or the other, then at least what is required is you should be in the state of wudu. You should make wudu and ablution before you get into the state of ihram. And then the third part is there's specific clothing. So for the men, there are two garments, two sheets, and one would cover the bottom portion of the body and one would cover the upper portion of the body. No stitched clothing for the men. For the sisters, it's your general Islamic clothing, and you should cover all your body except your face, your hands, and according to one report, your feet. So these are the clothing of ihram. Once you've taken a bath, you've put on your garments of ihram, then you perform two rakahs. Two rakahs to get into the state of ihram. So you perform these two rakahs, and you can recite any surah, any just like any two nafil prayers you would do. And then after performing the two rakahs, you make your intention of umrah. And if you're going to do this ihram for hajj, then you make your intention for hajj. And you recite the talbiyah. You recite the labbaik, which is on the screen here. And most of us know it. Labbaik, Allahumma labbaik. Labbaik la sharika laka labbaik. Innal hamda wal ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika lak. So what is the intention for Umrah? You just have to, in your heart, make this intention that I'm performing Umrah for the sake of Allah. And when you're doing Hajj, in your heart, you should have this, that you are now getting into the state of Ihram to perform your Hajj. There are many books where there are words you can say, Allahumma inni aradtu al-umrah, I have intended to do umrah, فَيَسِّرْهَا لِي وَتَقَبَّلْهَا مِنِّي. Oh Allah, make it easy for me and accept it from me. These are all wordings, but the minimum requirement is it should be in your heart that you're getting into ihram to perform umrah or you're getting into ihram to perform hajj. Now, what are the prohibitions during ihram? The main prohibitions are you cannot trim or cut your hair or nails when you're in the state of ihram. So, if you want to cut or trim your hair, then do it before you get into your ihram. Right? So if I know tomorrow I'm going to get into the ihram because I'm going to do my umrah or my hajj, then today I should shave and clip my hair and all that so that when I'm in the state of ihram, I'm not worried about that. The second prohibition is that there should be no perfume that is applied and there is no marital relations allowed in the state of ihram. So no scents, no deodorant, no perfume while in the state of ihram. You want to apply these things? Apply them before you get into the state of ihram. And then there is the general prohibition of avoiding all forms of sin, and in particular the Quran makes a mention of فَلَا رَفَثَ وَلَا فُسُوقَ وَلَا جِدَالَ فِي الْحَجِّ. There is no indecency, there is no transgression or sin, and there is no argumentation while in the state of ihram in hajj or umrah. So you avoid these in all times, but in particular we have to be very careful when in where we are performing umrah and hajj. Now there are certain things that are specific to men. Men are not allowed to wear stitched clothing in ihram. The men are not to cover their head or face. And the men should wear footwear that exposes the ankles and the upper portion of the feet. So these are flip-flops, so these would be ideal, or anything similar where your ankle is somewhat exposed and your upper portion of the foot is exposed. So that completes the requirements of ihram. Second fard element we said was tawaf. Tawaf literally means to go around. So we're going around the Kaaba 7 times. So where do we start our tawaf from? We start it from Hajrul Aswad, the black stone. How do we know where the black stone is? If you look at this image here, the embroidery is only at the corner where the Hajrul Aswad is, where the black stone is. All the other corners, they do not have the embroidery coming down. So this is a more closer view. The embroidery, the corner which has the embroidery is where the Hajrul Aswad is, where the black stone is. And that's an image of the black stone there. So we're going to be making tawaf starting from the black stone, and we're going to go around 7 times. So we start at the black stone, we end at the black stone. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. What do we do while we're making tawaf? You can recite any dhikr, any Quran, any dua in your own languages, in the also the Arabic language, whatever is easy for you. Make dhikr, make dua, make recitations. It is permissible to talk also. If it's necessary to talk, you can talk as well. You have to be in the state of wudu when you're making tawaf. If your wudu breaks while you're making tawaf, let's say you did 3 rounds and your wudu breaks, simple, you just go and make wudu, come back and start off where you left off. So if you've completed 3, and you broke your wudu, make your wudu, come back and start your 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th. Right? Now, after you've completed your tawaf, you're going to perform 2 rak'ahs of completion of tawaf. Where are these 2 rak'ahs generally performed? The instruction is to perform them somewhere near Maqam Ibrahim. Maqam Ibrahim is this casing we see here. There's a footprint of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam in there. And somewhere near there we should perform 2 rak'ahs. However, as you can see in this image, there's no space around. There's just flocks of people. And especially now, when there's a lot of construction going on at the haram, there's going to be hardly any space. So where are we going to perform the 2 rak'ahs? Anywhere in the haram, anywhere in the masjid, right? After performing the 2 rak'ahs, it is sunnah to drink zamzam. So there are stations where to drink zamzam. There are coolers also everywhere around the haram to drink zamzam. So you would drink zamzam there. So again, to recap, we're going to get into the state of ihram, and then we're going to do the tawaf. And both of these things are fard. We have to do them. Now we're moving on to the other two elements, which are wajib. Number one is sa'i, which is wajib. Sa'i means to literally run, to quicken one's pace. Now, when it comes to the sa'i, we start at Safa, the mountain of Safa, and we complete at Marwa. So by going to Safa to Marwa, that's one. Then from Marwa to Safa, that's two. Then Safa to Marwa again, that's three. Like that until we get to seven. So we're going to start at the mountain of Safa. We're going to end at the mountain of Marwa. Now, this is an image, aerial image of the Haram. So where you see the ring now is Safa, and then that's Marwa. So in between there, you're going back and forth. Sa'i. Again, an artist imagery here. One thing to note, while we're going between mountain of Safa and Marwa, there is a portion where there's green lights. So there, underneath the green lights, the men are encouraged to run a little bit faster or quicken their pace. And again, the idea is that this was the place where Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam couldn't see her child, her son, Ismail, so she quickened her pace. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, recommended that the men imitate that. However, he had mercy upon the women folk, so he did not encourage them to do that. So this is an older image of the mountain of Safa. We could get on it before, but nowadays they've blocked it off with a glass barrier, as you can see in the image there. So even if you go near it and you begin the sa'i, that is sufficient. And I was talking about the green lights. So there's green lights. Underneath the green lights, you're going to quicken your pace if you are brothers. Sisters don't have to. Now, some people ask the question, what if I'm with my wife or my sister and I have to run and she gets left behind? So when you're completed the running portion, you can wait there. And when your wife or your sister arrives, then you can continue doing the sa'i. Right? So that way, you're together still, inshallah. Again, another image of the green lights. And here in this image, you only see it at the beginning, at the end. But now what they have done is they've put the green lights all across the portion. Okay? And this is an image of Marwa, the mountain of Marwa. So that's where you go from Safa to Marwa. And you're going to go back and forth, completing seven times. And then the second thing that is wajib or necessary in Umrah is to shave or trim the hair. So obviously the sisters will trim 1 inch from the bottom of their hair. Brothers, they have the option, either shave their hair or trim the hair. What's the difference? The Prophet ﷺ prayed 3 times for the brothers who shave their hair, and he prayed 1 time for the brothers who trim their hair. So after shaving and after trimming, then now you have completed your umrah. So 4 steps, ihram, tawaf, sa'i, and halaq or qasr, which is shaving and trimming. So that completes the umrah. Now let's look at Hajj. Hajj, you will see, is a repetition of some of the things we just talked about. But the additional things is you're going to 3 additional places. You're not staying only in the haram. You're going to Mina, you're going to Arafat, and you're going to Muzdalifah. Right, so there are 5 days of Hajj. It starts on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, goes on to the 9th, 10th, 11th, and the 12th. Okay, so these are the 5 days of Hajj. So what do we do in Hajj? Before we look at that, we're going to look at an aerial view. If we try to understand this here, we'll get an idea. So right at the left corner, you see Mecca, you see the Kaaba. Right next to it is the space which is known as Mina. The land which is known as Mina, it's also the tents, where the tents are, it's known as Tent City. And you're going to begin your Hajj there as well. And then in the middle there is Muzdalifah. Also a few tents there, and this is where you collect pebbles. And then finally at the end is Arafat. Right? So location-wise, Arafat is the furthest away from Mecca. And the second furthest away is Muzdalifah, and the closest is Mina. Right, so we're going to start at Mina, we're going to go to Arafat, then we're going to go to Muzdalifah, and then come back to Mina. Okay, so what are we doing on the first day? The first day, you're going to get into the state of Ihram. And how do we get into the state of Ihram? I already explained it. You take a bath or make wudu, put on the clothing, and then perform the 2 rakahs, and then recite the talbiyah, make the intention of Hajj. So once you get into the state of ihram, you're going to leave for Mina. And you're going to be allocated a place to stay in the tents. You're going to stay in Mina and you're performing 5 salah there. Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr of the next day. So these are the 5 prayers that you're going to perform there. In between, what do you do? Again, dhikr, dua, supplication, learning and teaching, etc. So you get into the state of ihram, make your intention, and after sunrise, you get to Mina. And then you will be allocated a tent. And you're going to stay in your tent for performing 5 prayers. Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and Fajr of the next day. Okay, so the next day, the 9th. What do you do on the next day, the 9th? You're going to leave for Arafat after sunrise. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Arafatu al-Hajju Arafah. Hajj is going to Arafah, meaning it's the fard of Hajj. There's 2 things that are fard in Hajj. Going to Arafah and doing tawaf al-ziyarah. These are the two things that are fard. The other things, they are either wajib or sunnah. So you're going to leave for Arafat after sunrise. And you're going to stay there and make wukuf. Wukuf means you're going to stay there for a little while. So any time between the 9th, from midday to dawn the next day, you can stay. Even if a person spends a few minutes during this time frame, then their hajj would be complete. You're going to do 2 prayers there, dhuhr and asr. And after sunset, even though it's maghrib time, after sunset, you're not going to pray maghrib in Arafat. You're going to go to Muzdalifah, and in Muzdalifah, you're going to pray your maghrib and isha together. Okay, you're performing your Maghrib and Isha together in Muzdalifah at Isha time, and in Muzdalifah you're going to collect 70 pebbles. Okay, so we started Hajj with Ihram, we went to Mina, we performed 5 salahs there, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha, and the Fajr of the next day. The next day we moved to Arafat, and in Arafat we're performing 2 prayers, Dhuhr and Asr. And then when it's Maghrib time, when it's sunset, you're going to, without praying Maghrib, you're going to go towards Muzdalifah. In Muzdalifah, you're praying Maghrib and Isha together in Isha time. And you're collecting 70 pebbles. So after the sun rises, you're going to Arafat. You're performing Dhuhr and Asr. And then when the sun sets, you're going to Muzdalifah. And in Muzdalifah, you're collecting pebbles. Okay? After you perform your Maghrib and Isha together, you're collecting pebbles. 70 pebbles. Why are you collecting 70 pebbles? Because you're going to need 7 pebbles on the 10th. You're going to need 21 pebbles on the 11th. You're going to need 21 pebbles on the 12th. And 21 pebbles on the 13th. So this is the 3rd day of Hajj now, the 10th. And this is a busy day. So you're performing Fajr. And where are we right now? With Muzdalifah. So in Muzdalifah, you're going to stay any time from dawn to sunrise, and then you can make your way to Mina. Upon reaching Mina, what are you doing? You're doing 3 things. Number 1 is you're pelting only the large jamarat. So there are 3 jamarats, 3 pillars which symbolize where the devil intercepted Ibrahim. So the Prophet ﷺ, he told us that Ibrahim was faced with the devil, the shaitan. But each one of these 3 places, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he diverted the devil away. He didn't listen to the devil and he continued doing what Allah had commanded him. So in imitation, what we're doing is we're throwing these pebbles to make this commitment that I'm also not going to allow the devil, the shaitan, to ever overpower me. I'm going to be committed to what Allah has said and do things that are appropriate. So on this 10th day, we're throwing pebbles, 7 pebbles at the largest one. There's a large one, there's a medium one, and there's a small one. The second thing we're going to do is we're going to arrange for our animal to be sacrificed. So your group leader will tell you that your animal has been sacrificed. Now, once you know that, then you can shave or trim. And after shaving or trimming, there's only one thing that remains, and that is the fard tawaf al-ziyara. But tawaf al-ziyara does not have to be performed on the 10th. It can be performed on the 10th, on the 11th, or the 12th. But the other three things, the rami, meaning the pelting, the animal sacrifice, and the shaving, should take place on the 10th. Now, to remember this order, you can remember the word pass, P-A-S-S. P means pelting, A-S means animal sacrifice, and S means shaving or trimming. So on the 10th, we're going to be in Muzdalifah, and we're heading towards Mina. When we get to Mina, we're doing three things. We're going to do rami, we're going to pelt the largest jamara. We're going to have our animal sacrificed, and you will be told that your animals have been sacrificed. And then we're going to shave or trim our hair. Then there's only one thing that remains, and that is tawaf al-ziyara, which is the fard tawaf of Hajj. And again, as I said, that can be done either on the 10th, 11th, or 12th. So here's a picture of jamarat and throwing pebbles. So animal sacrifice, and then you can shave or trim your hair, and then what remains is tawaf ziyara. So there's specific timings for the pelting, and that is on the 10th, anytime from early dawn to the next day, zawal to sunset, is what we call mustahab, the recommended time. Okay, so how do we throw? We take the pebble, and we say, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, throw one pebble. Get the next pebble, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, throw the pebble. Don't take all together and throw it all together, or else that will only be counted as one. Okay? Okay, after halaq, meaning after the shaving and trimming on the 10th, all the prohibitions are lifted. So now you can get into your normal clothing, you can apply perfume, etc. You can trim your hair, you can clip your nails, etc. So the only thing that remains is tawaf ziyara, which is fard. The timing for tawaf ziyara is the 10th early dawn to 12th sunset. Okay? And now you're going to return to Mina. Meaning that if you go to do your tawaf, you have to come back and stay in Mina. You don't stay in Mecca, you stay in Mina for the 3 days that remain, 11th, 12th, and 13th. And on the 11th, 12th, and 13th, there's only one thing that needs to be done. And that is the pelting of all three jamarats. Okay? So on the 11th, the only action is pelting. Small, middle, and large in this order. Okay? Timing on the 11th and the 12th is from Zawal. Zawal means midday, to Subah Sadiq, which means the early dawn the next morning. And the dua is only in between. Meaning that if I am pelting the first jamara, I'm going to the second one. So in between I can make dua. Then I go to from the second one to the third one, in between I can make dua. But after the third one, I'm not going to be pelting, so there's no dua after that. You only make dua when there's two peltings on both sides. So you begin, you make dua, because you're pelting again. And then again, after that one, you can make dua because there's one more pelting. But after that pelting, there's no dua. Why? Because the dua is sunnah in between two peltings, right? And again, as I said, you spend your nights in Mina, in the tents. So the imagery of an artist here, you have Mina on one side, and you have the jamarat, the tents on one side, and the jamarat on the other. So you start off with the small, and you move up to the large when it comes to the pelting. So again, an imagery of the pelting there. And as I said, on 12th, 13th, you're doing the same thing as you did on the 11th. So you're pelting the three jamarat. Now, there is a verse of the Quran which says that if you're leaving early, meaning that you're only there for the 11th and the 12th, if you're doing what you call an express hajj, right, where you leave before the 13th, then the pelting of the 13th doesn't become necessary. But if you start, if you're there in Mina on the 13th early in the morning, then it's mandatory for you to pelt as well. But if you're not there, if you leave by after pelting on the 12th, then it's not necessary for you to pelt. So by doing that, your hajj is now complete. And once the hajj is complete, then what is recommended is before you leave, before you return, you make what you call tawaf al-wida, the farewell tawaf. It's not necessary, it's not mandatory, but it is something that is recommended. There are certain issues that are specific to sisters, and we'll just mention these, and then I'll open for any questions that you may have. So, the women in all of the above are the same as the men. So whatever we've described in terms of ihram, in terms of tawaf, in terms of sa'i, in terms of everything is exactly the same. What is different is they will keep their face uncovered, but their head will obviously have the hijab, but their face will be uncovered. The voice in the talbiyah, it's recommended for the sisters to keep their voices low when they recite the talbiyah. For the men, it's recommended that you recite loudly. There is one opinion amongst the fuqaha and the jurists that if all the sisters are reciting together and one particular sister's voice is not being identified, then it's fine. They can also read together loudly. If everyone in the bus or the coach is reciting loudly and a particular sister's voice cannot be identified, then it's fine. But in any situation, it's preferred that they keep their voice lower. There is no ramal in tawaf. What is ramal? Ramal means to walk in a very brave way with the chest out and the shoulders out. And this is recommended for the brothers in the first three rounds of the tawaf. How many times do we go around? 7 times. But the first three, you walk like soldiers. Why? Because when the Prophet ﷺ returned back from Medina to Mecca for the first time to do Umrah and Hajj, then the disbelievers had spread a rumor that the believers have gone weak. So the Prophet, peace and blessings upon him, said, let us show them that we're not weak, we're still mighty, we're still strong, we're still healthy. And then he asked the Sahaba, the companions, to in the first three rounds walk bravely like soldiers and then continue normal in the thing. So this is only for the men, this is not for the women. There's no running between in the sa'i. So sa'i is when you're going between the mountain of Safa and Marwa. So the running underneath the green lights, that's only for men, not for women. And obviously, the women will be trimming their hair, not shaving their hair. And if a woman is menstruating, then she will perform her ghusl. She will enter into ihram. The only thing that she's excused from is she will not perform the tawaf. Right? Why? Because the tawaf is in the masjid, and when in menstruation, they cannot enter the masjid. So we'll conclude there, because we also have Dr. Saab going to come forward. If anyone has any specific questions, feel free to ask them. I'll try to answer them within 5 minutes so that we can have the doctor come forward and make his presentations, inshallah. Are there any questions? Yes. Yeah, unscented perfumes, etc., are permissible. Soaps, unscented deodorant, that's fine. The questionable one is the one that has the scent. Okay. Yes. Yep. Yeah, multiple umrahs can be done. It is permissible. But every time you put on the ihram, you have to go out of the boundary. And there are different boundaries there. The taxi drivers will know where those boundaries are. But generally, the majority of the people, they go to a place called Tan'im or Masjid Aisha. And it's about 20 minutes in a taxi or a bus if there's not much traffic. And you put on your ihram there, you make your niyyah, you make your intention, and you come back in the vicinity, perform your umrah, and you can keep doing this as much as you want. Right? Sisters, have any questions? You feel free to either write them down or raise your hand and ask them. Yes, brother. Yes. Yes, there are some plagues and sicknesses, so if a person feels that they want to wear a face mask, it is permissible. There is permission for that because there is a necessity now, right? If there is a necessity, then they may cover their faces. Yeah. There's no fidya, but if you want to be on the safe side, you can give a little bit of sadaqah or charity, $20, that's fine. Yeah. Yep. In both in the tawaf and also the sa'i, it's not a requirement. So if someone doesn't raise their hand and do what we call istilam, it's fine. Their tawaf will still be done. Their sa'i will still be done. But if you want to follow the sunnah way is to do istilam. So when you're starting your tawaf, every round, you should face the Hajjul Aswad. You should say Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and then kiss your hands. The Prophet ﷺ, it's mentioned that he was once doing sa'i and he couldn't touch, tawaf, and he couldn't touch the Hajjul Aswad, and he had a staff, he had a stick. So he pointed it towards the Hajjul Aswad, and then he started the tawaf, right? So, no, for sa'i, you don't have to. You don't have to make istilam because there's no connection with Hajjul Aswad. What is recommended is you begin your sa'i with a dua. Every round you do, begin it with a brief dua, right? And then in between you can recite any dhikr or any Quran. Yeah. Yes. After sa'i, there's no mandatory or required nafil prayers. But if someone wishes to, that's fine, they can. But there's no requirement. Yeah. Yes, brother. Yes, you can comb in ihram, but if you feel that there's going to be too much hair that's going to fall out, it's better not to. But if you do it in a gentle way and you're trying your best not to allow hairs to fall off or come off, then that is fine. If one or two hairs, you're scratching your head and some hairs fall off, that's fine. It's you're not supposed to do this deliberately, right? You're not supposed to be literally taking scissors and cutting your hair or pulling out hair or chewing your nails or, you know, biting your nails, things like that. There is no special dua, but there are many books that have recommended dua. One of the verses is commonly recited. It's also written there, إِنَّ الصَّفَا وَالْمَرْوَةَ مِنْ شَعَائِرِ اللَّهِ. So that can be recited. There are other many masnoon dua books that have recommendations. So those can be recited. But again, if someone doesn't, their sa'i is still valid. Okay? Yes, sister. Any dua. So you raise your hand and you recite any dua. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً. Or in your own language, you make dua to Allah, right? These are special moments. Why? Because you're retracing and reenacting the steps of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, of Ismail and Hajar alayhi salatu wasalam. So it's so beloved moments. So at any one of these occasions, you can make any dua in any language, and inshallah Allah will answer your dua. Yes. Yes. Yes, you can. Because you're literally there to do the qurbani. Whether someone slaughters your animal or you slaughter your animal doesn't really matter. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yeah, usually your group leader will tell you that this is the rough time when your qurbani will be completed. So wait for that time before you shave your hair. Because most scholars say the order is necessary. You have to do on the 10th, you have to do the rami first, which is the pelting. And then you have to make the arrangements for the animal to be slaughtered. Then only you can shave or trim. So you should keep a window and keep in touch with your group leader, and he'll let you know when the animal was sacrificed or when is the approximate time. Yeah. Okay, so last few questions before I conclude here. Yes? You can perform Umrah for any person. You make your intention, O Allah, I am performing this Umrah, allow the reward of this to also be blessed to so-and-so. Now, if someone wants to do it for the Prophet ﷺ, that's fine. Does the Prophet ﷺ need our Umrah? No. Right? So, it is permissible, but, it's not something that the Prophet ﷺ encouraged. It's not something that is mandatory. But if someone feels, we want to afford this respect to the Prophet ﷺ, that's fine. For example, Ali radiallahu anhu, he made a commitment that every Eid al-Adha, he will do qurbani on behalf of the Prophet ﷺ. Right? Does the Prophet ﷺ need that? No, because his station is very high. His rewards are exemplary. But if someone wants to pay that respect to the Prophet ﷺ or anyone who's passed away, that's fine, it is permissible, but the intention has to be correct. That we're doing the qurbani or we're doing the umrah or the good deed for the sake of Allah, and we're praying to Allah, oh Allah, allow this reward to be blessed to so and so. Right? That's fine. Yes. You can make an estimation, right? Or when you're purchasing those tickets, ask the person who's selling those tickets to you that, you know, what's the commitment here of the timing. But let's say you have no connection, you don't know, then, you know, estimate the time that, okay, you know, probably this time, this is what he has suggested, or it's is the average time. If you're still not sure, then the further you delay, the better, right? Okay, so inshallah, we'll pass the microphone on to Brother Dr. Mumtaz, right? Inshallah. Jazakallah khairan.
Shukran jazila, Imam Sahab. In fact, I became wiser after listening to the deliberation of Imam Sahab in a very clear, eloquent way, my appreciation. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. First, congratulations to brothers and sisters who are proceeding the most important journey of their life. Without wasting time, I've got only less than 20 minutes at my disposal, so I'll try to scramble. In fact, you prepare everything. You are going here from Pakistan to Africa, everywhere. You prepare months ahead. But for Hajj, we start at the 11th hour. Please start preparing much before you go. One, congratulations. Second, it is Allah's order. Third, have vaccination of meningitis, which is there by law. Meningitis, gardan tor bukhar, is a terrible thing. And, you know, in certain countries, you just get the certificate and don't have it done. Don't do that. It's your own protection. Again, flu, cough is very, very common there. You must have heard everybody coughing. If you can get flu shots, nothing like that. Imam Sahib has explained that you have to run at places. You go for tawaf. You have to go for sa'i. You have to do walking. So if you're not used to walking, please start walking right now. What we call is you get cramps, you get exhausted, you can't perform, and there's no fun in, you know, especially ladies who are healthy and are overweight and gents with pot bellies. So prepare for today, become a slim fit long distance runner. Next is always take your medicine with prescription. Don't miss. You know, there they may check, you may be taking your medicines, they may be polite to you, and if you don't have a prescription, they may say, what is this? Throw that away and you will be without your medicine. Next, on reaching, go for your routine and prayers, but don't miss food. You have to be A1. You will be able to perform your dua, your work, your hajj, if you are physically well and you are mentally well. If you are having a backache, you are having a fever, you are can't sleep, you can't do anything. So you should be in a super fit situation. Have just that much amount of food which is necessary. Don't overeat. Don't go for biryanis and all that which are there outside. Take a lot of water. Avoid dehydration, especially when it is summer. The weather should be pleasant nowadays, but Zamzam is there which helps you spiritually as well as medically, and try to sleep little bit in between so you're not exhausted and chilled out the next day, so you can have your prayers in a fresh manner. Now I'll take common diseases. Many of the patients have got diabetes and they have to carry their medicine, but remember, as they are diabetic, they should take the portion of the food which they are used to taking at appropriate time, and also their medicine. As you will be walking and running, the requirement of medicine will be not the same what you are having here. So you can reduce the medicine to half, get a glucometer with you, you can check with them, and if your sugar is not within normal range, high or low, adjust your need. So people who are having insulin also should get their insulin in a cold chain. You can buy insulin from there and inject half the dose and adjust the dose after checking your blood sugar. Then number of middle-aged brothers get heart disease. They go with heart disease. There are two types of main heart disease, ischemic heart disease and heart failure. In ischemic heart disease, you get what is called as angina. If somebody gets chest pain right in the middle of center, and it may be in the middle age with a diabetic signaling for heart trouble, you can stop, you can slow down, or you can go out and get medical aid. Don't challenge your body. I've seen number of events happen. Anybody belonging to Lahore will know Nazir Butt Sabo, famous Nazir for Butt Sweets of Lahore, McClure Road. On the evening of 27th of Ramadan, we were together and he got a chest pain and he dropped dead. So after a lot of difficulty, the body was recovered. You know, there's so much rush. So you just protect yourself. If you have got heart failure, you're short of breath with the swollen feet, you take your pills with you and you can hire a ready or a carrier. Don't challenge your body. Next, people with blood pressure should also take their medicine, but at a low level, because by running, you know, there's heat produced and the blood pressure falls. Many of you get stomach diseases, burning. Avoid spicy food there. Those of you who are taking medicine for peptic ulcer or acidity, do carry them with you. You may get diarrhea there because people eat outside and the level of hygiene at times is not good. So have an antidiarrheal with you, or you can get medicine there. Many of you may be eating less and they get constipated. Just to relieve yourself, you can have Isabgol, or there are many tablets like Sana available there. And you must wash your hands. Safai nisaf iman hai. So must wash your hands so you get don't get infection before you eat, because there are lots of people and obviously the level of hygiene may not be so good. Chest infections are very, very common. Every person in fact gets chest infection, cough, expectoration, phlegm and flu. Please treat them in time and have antibiotics if necessary. Paralysis. There are many people who are paralyzed or who are having rush or Parkinson's disease. They should carry their medicine with them, especially Parkinsonian people. And if they don't take medicine, they will be frozen to ground. Joint diseases. Middle-aged people, they can't walk. And many of you may, pilgrims may be having backache. With backache, sleep on a hard floor. Avoid these soft mattresses. Because you get a backache, you will not be able to walk, you will not be able to perform Umrah, Hajj, Sa'i, Tawaf, everything goes down the drain. And with people with joint diseases, middle age, graceful age, you can hire, wahan pe mil jati hain, rediyan. Obviously they charge you, but make yourself comfortable, and then people can also carry, upar se, kandho pe utha ke carrier mil jati hain. Don't challenge your body again. Eyes. Many of you may be getting little eyes and red eyes. Pani ke chhinte mare, inshallah, theek ho jayenge aap zamzam se. Skin diseases. Some of you may be allergic. Don't go in so many fancy clothes even before. Have simple cotton clothes so skin doesn't become allergic. When you finish, then you can buy anything you like later on. Ladies special, they should, those in the premenopausal age, please have pill from your doctor so you don't menstruate there, as Imam Sahib has very eloquently said. We can avoid all. This is very simple in modern technology. Consult your family physician and have the pill before you lead. Injury. Well, I wish we Muslims are more disciplined. But the commonest injury, you know, there is injury to nose while trying to kiss Hajar-e-Aswad. Don't attempt it. If you can, La ikrafid deen, deen mein jabr nahi hai. So you symbolize it, as Imam Sahib has said, don't try to push yourself. This is a very, very common injury there. And again, foot injuries are there, especially in people with diabetes. They have to be very careful because infection spreads like jungle fire in diabetes. So if you get an injury, go to, I'll tell you from where to get help. Children, don't carry infants with you. Avoid children as far as possible. But if you have to carry them, then you have to take special care of them, their food, their infections, and their protection from injury, because lakhs and lakhs and millions of people are there. Now, where to find help? There in Makkah, there is in Mahalla Jiyad, Mushtashkal Jiyad, is one of the biggest hospitals you can get. They're all, you know, people. Saudi government has provided a lot of health. There are dispensaries by Pakistanis, Indians, and all Muslim countries. If you enter into Pakistani dispensary, and you can tell them Professor Mumtaz has given Islam, and they will do anything for you. Majority of them are my pupils there. In Medina Sharif, you go to Mushtashkal Malk, and there are other dispensaries also available. But please get help and don't challenge your body so you can go and come back in a comfortable manner. And there are psychological aspects. There are a lot of people, they become jittery. People try to fight with each other. People try to overrun you, overshoot you. Just remember that you are here in way of God, and don't raise your blood pressure, and don't react. As Allah Jalla Shanu has said, ke dar guzar karke chale, aapka safar achha guzrega, other person will also be there. And any questions, I've tried to be very, very brief and to the point, but feel free to ask me any number of questions. And last of all, also pray for me. Jazakumullah. Any questions? Everybody seems to be very healthy around. Is no more question? Please. Any food, but in moderation. Moderation, you can have both food, whichever taste you like. Woh jo hai na hadith ke thodi si bhook ho to khana chhod de. Act upon that, you'll be very comfortable. No more questions. Thank you very much for tolerating me over the rostrum. Jazakumullah. Fi amanillah. Yeah, there's one question from a sister. Yes, please. Flu shots you can have in next week. Probably you are going to have flu shots free in Toronto area, as far as I know. Mid-October, but you can try it. You can go there and buy flu shots. They may not be 100% protection, but let me tell you, cough and flu is so common.